Namaste, Sarasati Devi. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, Hare Krishna. Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Gopi Ramana Swami, And then we'll come to the text on the board. So, reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 8, often titled Mohini Murti Bewilders Lord Shiva, text number 17. Si Sugubacha. This one's not on the board. So, just leave it.
Ite Bruvana Bhagavam Statai Vantara Diyata Sarvatas Charayam Chakshur Bhavasti Sahomaya.
Sukadev Goswami continued, after speaking in this way, the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vishnu immediately disappeared, and Lord Shiva remained there with Uma, looking for him all around with moving eyes.
Tato dadarso pavane.
No, sorry.
Tato dadarsu pavane vriyam vichitra pusparuna palavadrume vikridatam kanduka lilaya lasat dukula paryastanitam amekalam.
Thereafter, in a nice forest nearby, full of tree with reddish pink leaves and varieties of flowers, Lord Shiva saw a beautiful woman playing with a ball. Her hips were covered with a shining sari and ornamented with a belt.
Avartana dvartana kampita stana prakrista rurubare padi padi prabhajamana miva matyadas chalat pada pravalam nayatim tatastata.
Because the ball was falling down and bouncing up, and she played with it, her breasts trembled, and because of the weight of those breasts and her heavy flower garlands, her waist appeared to be all but breaking at every step, as her two soft feet, which were ready like coral, moved here and there.
Diksu bedamat kanduka chapale brisam prudvikna tarayata lulalochanam swakarna vibrajita kundala lulasat Kapola nila laka manditananam.
The woman's face was decorated by broad, beautiful, restless eyes, which moved as the ball bounced here and there from her hand. The two brilliant earrings on her ears decorated her shining cheeks, reflections, and the hair scattered on her face made her even more beautiful to see. Then Text 21.
Slatadukulam kabarim chavichutam.
Slatadukulam chavichutam.
Sanayatim vamakarena valguna.
Sanayatim vamakarena valguna.
Viniknatim manyakarena kandukam.
Viniknatim manyakarena kandukam.
Vimohayam jagadatma maya. Slakadukulam kabarim chavichutam.
Slakadukulam chavichutam.
Sanayatim vamakarena valguna.
Slackening.
Slipping or slacking.
Dukulam.
Dukulam.
Dasari.
Dasari.
Kabarim cha.
Kabarim cha.
And the hair on the head.
And the hair on the head.
Vichutam.
Vichutam.
Being slackened.
Being slackened.
And scattered.
And scattered.
Sanayatim.
Sanayatim.
Trying to bind.
Trying to bind.
Vamakarina,
Vamakarina,
with the left hand.
With the left hand.
Vaguna,
Vaguna,
very beautifully attractive.
Viniknatim,
striking.
Striking.
Anyakarina,
with the right hand.
Kandukam. was Krishna. Anyway, then Lord Brahma returned, and then Krishna showed Lord Brahma by changing all these cowboys and calves into Vishnumurtis. And upon seeing all these Vishnumurtis, you know, four heads, oh, Supreme Lord, that was clear. Lord Brahma understood, and Lord Brahma, the penny dropped, and Lord Brahma realized the mistake he had made. Then he offers many prayers. Some of the prayers are a little calculative. He's saying that, like, oh, my dear Lord, I am known as Aja, one who has no father and mother, but in actuality, you are both my father and my mother, because I appeared from your navel on the lotus flower. Therefore, you are like both my parents. And when a child passes stool or urine on the lap of the mother, she doesn't take it very serious. So in this way, my Lord, please overlook my mistakes. So he was trying to get Krishna to overlook his mistakes. And then Lord Brahma, who is supremely intelligent, Lord Brahma is the most intelligent living entity in the entire universe. Then Lord Brahma was explaining that even when one day the scientist will be able to count all the atoms in the universe, which of course is impossible, the atoms in the universe, you couldn't even count the atoms in a room like this. But even if they would be able to count all the atoms in the universe, they still could not count the qualities of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Even if one could count all the snowflakes in the sky, of course there are no more snowflakes these days, but long ago there used to be snowflakes, even in Radhadesh, before it got tropical. Yes, if one could count the snowflakes in the sky, even if, which is also impossible, they're moving, it's not so easy, Did I get that one already or not, They're moving, so it's hard to count them. But even if they would achieve that fact, they still could not understand the Supreme Lord. As Lord Brahma also states in the Brahma Samhita, Pantastu koti satavatsara sampragamyo vayoratapi manaso munipungavanam. So pyasti yat prapadi chintyabhi chintya tatve govindam adi purusham tamaham bhajami. Even if one travels with the speed of mind, which is fast, right? Because we can immediately, if I say Japan, are you there? Are you there? Tokyo? All these people, really busy people everywhere. No space. Look in the garbage can, old tape recorders are just thrown away. There are electronics everywhere. Tokyo. Maybe a Zen monk walking in the street with a lampshade head on. You're seeing Tokyo. I just said Japan. See, we can travel there with the speed of mind very quickly. But even then, one cannot touch the tip of the toe of the Lord. So, in this way, we can appreciate that ultimately, to see reality is not a matter of building up our power. It is not about our power. I have gradually practiced this process of bhakti yoga. I have thoroughly studied all the Vedic literature. I am now approaching the absolute truth. Approaching, but you'll never get there. The only way we'll get there is by pleasing Krishna. Bhaktyamam abhijanati yavanyaschas. What is yavanyaschas? What's the second line? Chasmi. I'm struggling. Yeah, that I know. The chasmi. The chasmi, the whole sentence, please. Think about it. Yavan?
Yavan
yas chasmi tatvata. Yavan yas chasmi tatvata. Okay, got it. Yavan yas chasmi tatvata. So, we can only approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead through His mercy. By pleasing Him and by pleasing His devotees. And no one is so powerful that he is not influenced by the illusory energy. Even Lord Brahma can sometimes become bewildered by the illusory energy. Therefore, it's never that like we can think, oh well, you know, now I've been a devotee for 99 years, you know what I mean? Like Maya can't touch me. What can Maya do to me? Yeah. It doesn't affect me. Yeah. Whatever I see. I mean, you know, nowadays, Kali Yuga, you see all kinds of things. Doesn't affect me. No, does nothing. Nothing. I'm a bhakti yogi. You know? No. We should understand that actually Srila Prabhupada is explaining about Ajamiya. And he was saying Ajamiya was a qualified Brahmana. Ajamiya went through a gurukul, Ajamiya was properly trained, he was highly learned. But when Ajamiya came face to face with Maya, Ajamiya fell down. So Prabhupada said, so if Ajamiya fell down, then what's our chance? How can we not fall down? Say, so, well, okay, but we have the chanting of the holy name. Yeah, later on, Ajamil had that in a namabhas form, but not like a sadhana, like we are chanting. So that protects us. Yeah, but that's not all. That's not all. We have the mercy of Lord Chaitanya, who interferes, who is right there every time, and Maya is there, and we get hit, and Lord Chaitanya, okay, gets in between, sort of blocks it, okay. He's protecting us. In that way, we are somehow or other able to stand in the face of Maya, weak as we are. And even then it's hard. Right? Oh Maya, oh Maya, oh Maya, oh Maya. Not so easy to say no. Not so easy. Consistently, not so easy to never have a moment of weakness. Not so easy to never slip. Not so easy to remain faithful, to take vows for a lifetime and then follow them for a lifetime. Not so easy. Not so easy. Anyway, still, the vows are so powerful that even if not perfectly performed, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta says, still, generally they will be successful. So that is also something. See Article Pinat. So by somehow or other, we are following a system. We're following a system of controlling the mind, controlling the senses, engaging the mind, engaging the senses. Not controlling the mind and senses by willpower. Yes, there is an element of willpower there to say no. But willpower would not do it because we don't have much willpower in this age. Our capacity for austerity is not very great. Therefore, by willpower, it may become very, very hard. If you think of someone like Bhishma Dev, he could just, on the strength of willpower, be a celibate while living in a royal palace. But for us, that is not so easy. When I was temple president in Vrindavan, there was one brahmachari who came to me with a complaint. And he said that I want to complain about this Mataji. I said, okay, what is it? He said, she's looking at me all the time. So I said, well, if you can see that she's looking at you all the time, then you must be looking at her all the time as well, isn't it? He says, no, you don't understand. I said, no, I understand very well. Very well. He said, no, you don't understand. She loves me. I said, get out of here. Just get out of here. I mean, too much. Tell us too much. She loves me. Yeah? There was one, here in Radhadesh, there was one skinny lady with two enormous suitcases. And she was going up the stairs, trying to carry them one by one, dragging these big suitcases up. So one brahmachari next to me says, I can't let her do that. I said, are you sure? He said, no, I must. So he helped. 2 years later, he had two babies. I'm not speaking out against babies. I'm not speaking out against family life. But I'm speaking about how one thing leads to another. Yeah, so you better be sure. If you want to carry suitcases, you also have to be ready to have babies. Yeah? And all these other things. It goes like that because it's not possible to just carry some suitcases without consequences. Yeah? It's not so simple. Life is not, everything has consequences. And the ladies also, the ladies have a special power. And, you know, if they just anything, you know, can you please pass the salt? It's already too much. you might say, what? It's the butter fire principle. The butter already melts. It does. The butter melts quick. Especially these days, you know. Because they don't keep it in the fridge. They have to keep the butter in the fridge by following Vedic principles. Keep it cool. But because we don't, the butter is already half melted. And then it doesn't take much to melt that butter. And then, oh, it just happened. Yeah. What? We don't understand how. Yeah. Okay. So, that is all right, you know. We are not here to say that everyone should be a sannyasi. But everyone should go back to Godhead. Right? That's for sure. Right? The goal of life is not to have babies. Yeah? It's all right to have babies, but then Jananis yasnasasyat, guru nasasyat, pita nasasyat. Don't be a mother, don't be a father if you can't take your kids back to Godhead. Well, then you have to go yourself. Otherwise, it will be hard. And then we have to be deeply connected to Krishna. One may think, yeah, okay, sounds a little fanatic. Well, no, it's not that. It's just that I'm getting older and running out of time. So, you know, it's getting more serious. As when you're young, you play a bit, you know, say, well, you know, come on. Can't be fanatic. When you're older, they think, well, you know, I'd better pull my socks up now, right? I'd better get a little bit more strict now because, you know, I might not make it. So in this way, like in the Bhagavatam, the Grihastha Ashram is described as the dark well, right? Now, the Grihamedi goes for it, dives into it head down, you know? Straight, let's go. A grihastha, usually these wells, they also, I've learned from India, they have steps inside. So you don't have to go to the bottom. And it's not necessary to go to the bottom. One can sort of try not to go, take it too far. It's possible. That helps. It only helps on the way back to Godhead. And why not? Whatever helps on the way back to Godhead, let's embrace it. Here we see that Lord Shiva became also bewildered, but this time not by a woman of this world, but by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who acted now as a woman, as Mohini Murti. And because, why not Lord Shiva? Because Lord Shiva is not a jiva. Lord Shiva, Shiva Tattva is like this, is that there is, in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, Sanatana Goswami explains it, and it also is explained by Jiva Goswami in the Sandarbhas. He says, between the material world and the spiritual world, there is the Viraja River. On the spiritual side of the Viraja River, there is a Shiva Loka, and that is the abode of Sada Shiva. And then on the material side of the Viraja River is Mount Kailash, and that is where the demigod Shiva resides. So here, we're dealing with the demigod Shiva, who resides there. And now it is said, Ksira dadi yata vikara visesi yogat, that as Lord Mahavishnu, as Lord Mahavishnu is about to begin the creation, he is glancing on the pradhana. The pradhana is the potential of the material, of the mahatattva, of the entire material energy. It's the potential, but not yet manifest. Then, when the Lord Saiksata, the Lord glances upon that pradhana, then it becomes activated and impregnated with living beings. It is said, Lord Shambhu, Lord Shiva, becomes that glance. He becomes the glance. In this way, Lord Shiva is known not only as the destroyer, but also as Shambhu is also the generative principle. It's like he who actually impregnates the material energy and is actually getting in touch with it. In the cause of that, there is a transformation where milk is transforming into yogurt, where Lord Shiva is transforming from Vishnu Tattva into a Tattva on his own. So he is still Vishnu Tattva, even in the demigod form, but it said, due to the material association, Jiva Goswami says it's like a lamp, an oil lamp, which becomes black with the soot, that black stuff from the flame, which makes the glass all black, then the light can no longer come through. So this is the case with the difference between Sada Shiva and the demigod Shiva. So, but even that demigod Shiva is so powerful that he's not bewildered. He's not bewildered by the female energy. No, not attracted to the material energy. Always fixed in transcendence. But of course, when Krishna came as Mohini Murti, then other story. And then there was nothing that anyone can do because he is all attractive. Anyway, why is the material energy so attractive? Why is the material energy so powerful? Why is Maya so strong? Because the material energy is the reflection of the unlimited spiritual energy. Therefore, Maya is very vast. Maya is therefore everywhere. Maya is just, there's no limit to it. And there's so much variety because it gets all that variety from the unlimited spiritual energy, from Krishna. And that is why Maya is so powerful that she can overcome the infinitesimal, the small living entities. Therefore, one should never take it to the edge. One should keep a safe distance from the illusory energy, not thinking, it will be okay. And in the Prema Vivarta, which is a book written by Jagadananda, Pandit, close associate of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it is stated, Krishna Bhaya Mukahaya Bhogavan Chakara Nikatastamaya Tarajapatiyahaya. It is said that the external, as soon as we start playing with the material energy, with the objective to enjoy it, then what happens is nearby Nikatastamaya, nearby stands Maya. So as soon as we start to play with the material energy, nearby stands Maya, and it says, Tara Japati Ahaya, ready to slap you down. And you thought it was a what about fall down? No, not about what about fall down. What about being slapped down by Maya? Therefore, never take it to the edge. Because when we take it to the edge, Maya will slap us down. Therefore, Rupa Goswami has given us the actual transcendental path. Rupa Goswami has given us in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu a very interesting formula. Namely, the same senses that bind us in the material world, the same senses that make us fall prey to Maya, now engage those senses in service of the Lord. And those same senses will liberate us. And then, in the next devotion, we find in detail described how to engage the senses in the service of the Lord. So, that is the point of my lecture. The point is not... Now, the Grihastha Ashram is a condition where we're trying to follow a heroic path. We're trying to overcome the natural tendency to enjoy material life. But there is a certain amount of material activities which one can enjoy. That is authorized. Now the tendency is to stretch the envelope. Right? That is the tendency of the mind and the senses. So the mind and the senses feel a little bit confined in Rupa Goswami's envelope. So they try to stretch the envelope. Of course, if you stretch an envelope too much, you sometimes try to put something in an envelope which is a little bit too big, and then what happens? It rips. So there's the chance that it will rip. So that risk is there. The renounced, the other three ashrams are more renounced, and the other three ashrams are... but the problem there is that one may lack in realization, and then all that renunciation becomes very dry. I came to one temple, and there was a brahmachari temple president. And I came, and he wasn't there. I said, oh, how's so-and-so? He said, oh, he went to the beach. Okay, he went to the beach. They said, 3 days ago. I said, 3 days ago? He said, yes, he went to the beach 3 days ago, and he never came back. I said, what happened? He said, he just went there, he sat down in front of the ocean, and he's already sitting there for 3 days. I said, let's go to the beach. So we went to the beach, and I saw him there. And they let me out of the car. I walked up to him and sat down next to him. After about 15, 20 minutes, I said, nice view, isn't it? trying to strike up a conversation. And anyway, okay, we got talking. And then it came to the point that what had happened to him. What had happened to him was that at one point the question had hit him. The big question. Who am I really? So, this who am I really? How can we not come to that point that we wind up on some beach somewhere? How can we avoid that beach? Or some might say, well, it's good, you know, you go to the beach, no, you gotta go through it, you know, who am I really? It's actually healthy. You know, it's real growth, authenticity. Who am I really? Very good. So considering all this, how can we, in our fight with Maya, how can we actually win if we're not authentic? A whole life artificial. I eat only carrots because they're saffron. how long can we eat only carrots? Are you a rabbit? It's not so easy to eat only carrots. You even turn orange if you eat too many carrots. So it says. Yeah. Anyhow, one wants something else sometimes, you know. Little cheese, you know. Little, something, you know. Yeah, so how can we artificially renounce the world? We cannot. Therefore, the only answer to this is we must really have a desire to please Krishna and really be preoccupied with a desire to please Krishna. And when we are serving Krishna with a desire to please Him, then He becomes pleased, and when He becomes pleased, then we become pleased, automatically. And when we're pleased, it says, one who wears the shoes of satisfaction does not feel the thorns on the path of material existence. If we wear the shoes of satisfaction, where is austerity? Then it's possible to find Maya. But without the shoes of satisfaction, good luck. Let's see how long you will last. Statistics are against you. All right. With all these little tidbits of information, I hope I have thoroughly confused you. But in case someone still sees the thread, maybe there are some questions. Maybe some want to go to the beach and talk about that. It's all right. Maybe some want to be heroes. Maybe some want to stretch the envelope. How to stretch an envelope without ripping it? Is there a way? Maybe. Yes.
A very confusing question.
A very obvious question?
Confusing question.
Confusing question. That's good.
When we're in the spiritual world, there is no Maya.
Okay.
So how can we become attracted by Maya if there's no Maya?
The fall down of the jiva, you mean?
Yeah, well, you mentioned it.
You want to go to the fall down of the jiva?
No, well, not really, but...
Well, and you did, you just did.
It's inconceivable.
No.
But the next question is that if even there,
no, that's all wrong reasoning.
Yeah.
All wrong. It doesn't happen like that. The way it happens is this, is that the living being has the same qualities as Krishna, but in minute form. So within Krishna, there's independence, and there is the capacity to be master and enjoyer. That capacity is inherent within Krishna. So because the jiva has the same qualities, those qualities are also in minute form present in Krishna. But in the spiritual world, the living beings are not utilizing that propensity in the fullest sense. They are simply absorbed in being the servant. the servant of the servant of the servant. It's all about serving. It's all about pleasing Krishna. So, upon eternity, a living being in the spiritual world could simply stumble over the possibility without any attachment, without any attraction, stumble over the possibility and then ponder on that possibility for a moment. Pondering on that possibility is actually tatastha, the marginal position on the edge, tata, that's on the edge. As soon as one ponders that possibility, the absorption in service is for a moment interrupted. One is not fallen. One has no envy. One has no material desire. One has nothing like of the sort. But from the tatastha position, is it possible to develop that? From the tatastha position, there are two options. Go straight back to service, reject that option. Say, like, no. The thought can come upon eternity. I could also be master and enjoyer. And just thinking about that is tatastha. Then, if that goes on from, if the next thought would be interesting, curiosity kills the cat. Or if one thinks, no, this is rubbish, especially if one has already been to the material world, one will remember at that point, then one will return. So, very simple. So there's no such thing as thinking about Maya. I'm sitting in the spiritual world serving Krishna forever. My God, it's been long eternity. And there's no vacation. No pay and no vacation. I tell you, I need a break, you know. I've been working too long, too hard. I need a break. I want to go to Saint-Tropez, you know. And you book your holiday. Yeah, where you want to go? Croatian coast, Italy, bravo, Italy, it's calling, you got it? Anyway, that's one explanation on this matter. Bhagavati. Yes, yes, that choice always stays with us. And we have to choose for Krishna. We have to be sure we want to choose for Krishna. And we may lose that motivation over time, no? Because although it's not eternity, still it feels so long, even many years. And that's why we go to the beach. Who am I really? But if we wear the shoes of satisfaction, then no need to go to the beach. So how to get that satisfaction? Any other questions? Yes.
When I'm deeply suffering, there's no desire to want to serve anyone.
Yeah.
Because the pain is overwhelming.
Yeah. Yeah, when we are deeply suffering, then we lose the desire to serve because the pain is overwhelming. Yeah. It's at that time that we have to remind ourselves. It's like, yes, I'm deeply suffering, and it's like, but the only way out of here. Is there a way out of here? Said the juggler to his wife. Is there a way out of here? The only way out of here is still Krishna consciousness, whether you suffer or not. The only way out of suffering is Krishna consciousness. There's no other way out. How to get out? See, I've suffered also. and I think some other, everybody suffers, no? And still suffers. But how do you get out of there? So I stop my service. But how do I get out? And then I just go into the suffering. That's all that's left. Yeah? I stop everything, stop chanting. It's too painful, too much pain. Then I just go into the pain. I'll be just a ball of pain. So that's not a great position to be in for a long time. I can handle it for a short moment, but then I got to do something to get over that pain. So then I start chanting Hare Krishna again. Because I realize there's no other solution. It's the only way out is chanting Hare Krishna. So I had this. The dentist, because I travel, I go to different dentists. Sometimes I went to this dentist, was doing a root canal and closed up the tooth, leaving some cotton with chemicals inside. But didn't tell me that he did it. And was in there for 2.5 years. Then I got the toothache of my life. Not only toothache, a jaw, you know? I mean, whoa! And they couldn't find anything. They did x-rays, they said, everything is fine. Only finally they opened it up, then they found the cotton. And so I was suffering, and it's just Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. And then I went to the dentist, and the dentist looked at it, and the nurse in the back said, extraction, extraction, extraction. And I heard this extraction. I said, oh my God, there must be something they can do. No, they're going to pull it out. No, extraction. And then they said, oh, this is going to be a very difficult one. I said, oh no, it's going to be a very difficult one. My dentist says, no, I don't think I can do it. You have to go to a specialist. My dentist is sort of a nice person, devotee, who sort of always says, are you all right, Maharaj? Are you okay? I hope it doesn't hurt. He's sort of very sympathetic. He sent me to the specialist. The specialist was huge, a big man with enormous hands, you know, big guy. I come in, the specialist sort of helps me in the chair, sit down. Open your mouth. I wasn't sure at that moment. I had doubts about opening my mouth, but there was no way escaping anymore. And then, crunch, crunch, and I heard the thing breaking to many pieces. And he said, oh, it's a little brittle. That is a problem. So anyway, and then he started bringing out other tools, and he was hammering and chiseling and things and taking out, and I knew, you know, this is going to be serious. It made a hole in my jaw, not only pulled out the tooth, but dug it out. Oh my God, I was suffering. And all along, I was remembering a lecture of Prabhupada about a herb, and he said, there's this herb, and if you touch it to the tooth, all the bacteria will leave. And I said, if only he would have said the name of the herb. he didn't say the name, you know. It was like, what herb would that be? Anyway, I have this charming dimple on the left side. It's not charming, it's because there's a huge hole there and no tooth. Suffering. But what to do? Somewhere in the pain, as chanting Hare Krishna, it brought some relief, something, at least a shelter. What else is there? Doctor, give me a pill. Have you read the little paper that comes with the tablets? Huh? Yeah. Yeah. Have you? I got shingles. You know what shingles is? What's your language? Good. Huh? Anyway, these are like it's like a rash, and it looks like little flowers, and it just goes all around. It spreads, or it goes everywhere in this, and it affects the nerves. It affects the nerves, and it goes, therefore, the nerves get infected as well, so it hurts like hell, and it's like painful. So, okay, got the medicine. I read the paper. The paper says, this medicine can cause hallucinations. It then I read some more symptoms, heart palpitations, high blood pressure. These are the normal things, right? And then it says, again, can cause schizophrenia. Like, God, that's two times in one paper, you know? Anyway, I took it. And as I took it, I felt my mind was going like, all it was made of rubber. But it helped with the with that thing, and everything is fine. Except, well, I think it's okay. That little green man, who is since then always traveling with me, sitting on that chair over there. You see, with purple eyes. Anyway, in the midst of all that, what else can you do but chant Hare Krishna? I thought I had hemorrhoids. Those are things you get in this world, you know. Jeez, I thought, now I've got it. Went to the hospital to get him, take him away. Doctor says, sorry. We're so sorry. I said, what is it? He said, it's a tumor. I said, okay. He said, yeah, we got to take out the whole rectum. I said, a rectum? No rectum. It's not so good, eh? A bag. Anyway, I went to another doctor. Now I'm so glad I can still go to the bathroom. These are little things in life. What can we do? Yeah, we suffer, but there's no other way than to do service. Therefore, temporarily we give up the service, but then with intelligence we understand, no, I gotta do some service, something. So we see people who have, devotees who have suffered, they come back after to do some service. Because that service is the only thing, only way out of here. What else is there? Yeah, I want to get out of this place. We gotta get out of this place. You can. No, that's all right. Prabhupada said we can desire to go back to Godhead. That's fine. Of course, when you are a Paramahansa, you know, a totally liberated devotee, then you may be beyond that. But for us, let's do service to get out of here. Back to Godhead. Let's go. As soon as possible. I mean, not right now. But even if right now, you know. Because maybe we can live a nice life in devotional service, and then when we are 108, then we can go back. But some go sooner, whatever. But let's go back. So let's never do anything that interferes with that. Anyone else? Otherwise I stop. Okay.
You mentioned these two Shivas, like spiritual Shiva and material.
Yeah.
Mentioned Saraswati, which is not
Saraswati,
which is not mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam. And in Brahma Samhita it says that Goddess Saraswati told to Brahma,
Vishnu
versus Tapa. So I'm curious, is there also...
There also is another expansion of Saraswati in the spiritual side. Yes. Yes.
So also some demigods can...
Yeah. They're also devotees. So they also have an aspect. Okay. Let's have a break. Fast. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Swami Kadamba Kanana Swami ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Sure.
this is what it says.
I still think
I'm
yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.